Complex functions are studied in complex analysis, and they are not easy to visualize compared to functions of real variable. Here the symbol R refers to the set of real numbers. In the case of a real function, we can represent it using the Cartesian plane. We draw the x-axis and then the y-axis. We consider a value on the x-axis and apply the function to obtain f evaluated on that value. We do this for every value in the domain of the function to obtain a two-dimensional curve. The value x0 is known as the input and the value y0 is known as the output. Consider now the set of complex numbers. These are objects of the form x plus I times y, such that x and y are real numbers and the symbol I is the square root of minus 1, the imaginary constant. For a function defined on the complex numbers, we have that for z, a complex number, then z has real and imaginary components. And the output f evaluated at z to be equal to u plus I times v is also a complex number with real and imaginary components. As a result, the graph of a complex function exists in a four-dimensional space. For that reason, we cannot visualize complex functions, since we are only able to perceive three dimensions. But don't worry, the good news are that we can use what we know about plotting functions of real variables in two dimensions or in three dimensions. In fact, there are well-known methods to visualize complex functions, for example, plotting real and imaginary components, analytic landscapes, mappings, and domain coloring. This is the method that we're going to focus on this video. So what is domain coloring? Domain coloring is a technique for visualizing complex functions by assigning a color to each point of the complex plane. This technique was proposed by the mathematician Frank Farias in the 90s as an alternative way to explore geometric properties of complex functions. And how domain coloring works? Essentially, there are two main points to consider. First, assign a color to every point in the complex plane. Second, color the domain of the function f by painting the location z, the input, with the color determined by the value of f evaluated at z, the output. To make sense of these two points, let's consider the complex plane. The horizontal axis represents the real component and the vertical axis, the imaginary component. Any complex number then can be represented as a point on the complex plane. We can also represent this complex number in a polar form using the exponential representation, that is r exponential of I times theta. Here r is equal to the square root of x to the power of 2 plus y to the power of 2. This is also denoted with this symbol and is known as the modulus. Theta, on the other hand, is the angle counterclockwise measured that it is made with the point, the origin, and the real axis. We call this angle phase or argument of z. We will consider the value of theta between 0 and 2 pi. Now we map this angle to the rainbow colors, or more precisely, to the hue. So for example, if the point z is in this position, the first quadrant, we measure its phase, theta. The value is then mapped to this yellow color, and finally we color the point using this color yellow. For different values of the phase, we will have different colors of the point. We can plot one by one every complex point on the plane until we have colored the full complex plane. Here you can appreciate the domain coloring representation of the identity function, where the color represents the phase of the value of the function plotted on its domain. These plots are called phase portraits, a term that we will use from now on. Now let's take a look to some basic examples of phase portraits. Here we have again the identity function. Now this is the function 1 over z. Notice how the colors have been reflected with respect to the real axis, something that we can appreciate better here. Now let's plot a slightly more complicated function. Consider the function z minus 1 over z squared plus z plus 1. This is a rational function with the following phase portrait. There are a few mathematical properties we can explore with this phase portrait. not, for example, that f evaluated at 1 is equal to 0. We say that 1 is a 0, or a root, of the function f. Also notice that f is undefined at the complex numbers set 1 and set 2. These are called poles of the function. You can use face portraits to locate zeros and poles easily. We just need to look at where all the colors meet. The only issue is that if we do not know the expression that defines the function f, it is really hard to determine which points are zeros or poles. We can solve this problem by introducing the level curves of the modulus applied to the function. These kind of plots are known as enhanced face portraits. Recall that we use the hue to match the values of the face from 0 to 2π. Instead of using an interval, we can wrap those values to obtain the color wheel. And in fact, we can introduce two more components by considering the HSB scheme to obtain the enhanced face portraits of complex functions. Here, the HSB scheme stands for hue, saturation, and brightness. For the face portraits that I showed you at the beginning, I considered the hue to be equal to the face, and the values of the saturation and brightness were both equal to 1. To obtain an enhanced face portrait, we can modify either the saturation or brightness. Let's just modify the value of the brightness in here. Instead of 1, we introduce this function, which contains the required information to plot the level curves of the modulus of the function, logarithmically spaced. So, initially we had a plain face portrait. If we include the level curves of the modulus, we obtain this new plot, shown on the right. We can also plot the level curves of the face by introducing this expression in the brightness. And of course, we can combine them both to obtain this tiling. With this introduction of the level curves of the modulus, we can easily identify zeros and poles. Notice how the shading changes in the regions between the level curves. For example, when the function has a zero, the shading goes from lighter to darker. On the other hand, when the function has a pole, the shading is inverted. It goes from darker to lighter. Here we have again the plain face portrait of this rational function. We already identified 3 points where the colors meet. Using the enhanced face portrait, we can see that the point on the right is a zero and the other 2 points on the left are poles. I'm sure you can identify on these enhanced face portraits the poles and zeros without knowing the function. Just pause the video for a few seconds to see if you can do it. So the zeros are these 3 points and the other 2 points are poles. We can confirm this by analyzing the rational function that corresponds to this enhanced face portrait. If we look at the numerator, we can see that there are precisely 3 zeros. On the other hand, the denominator indicates that there are exactly 2 poles. Domain coloring allows us to visualize complex functions. In particular, by using enhanced face portraits, we can easily identify zeros and poles of functions. Additionally, we can visualize and explore many other mathematical properties such as multiplicity of zeros, roots of unity, the fundamental theorem of algebra, and also classification of singularities. Further exploration of these topics and more will be covered in a separate video. Another benefit of domain coloring is its ability to serve as a powerful tool for creating breathtaking mathematical artwork. Here, for example, you can appreciate the enhanced face portrait of a finite power series. And even simple face portraits reveal stunning symmetries and organic forms. The possibilities are endless. And also, we can consider other color schemes. Here, RGB stands for red, green, and blue. Or we can use a discrete version of a HSB scheme, or a black and white color scheme. And instead of including the level curves of the modulus, we can add level curves of the real and imaginary components to study, for example, the electric potential or hydrodynamics. If you want to explore different color schemes, then I will recommend you to check these online plotting tools. With these tools, you can explore a great variety of complex functions. You can share your plots with your friends or save them to your computer. I will leave the link in the description. Finally, if you want to learn more about complex functions, then I recommend you to check this online book, Complex Analysis, a Visual and Interactive Introduction. Link in the description. Well, that's all. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, please consider becoming a member in my Patreon. Have fun exploring complex functions with domain coloring. Bye bye.